You can call me Elizabeth.
We were all buried at sea. We just didn't know it yet.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, T-Young here, and welcome to a Bioshock Infinite Burial at Sea news update. In my previous video, I analyzed the DLC's first trailer, which revealed a number of interesting details, like the fact that Rapture is the main setting for a new Booker and Elizabeth timeline and story. Today, I'm going to be talking about details revealed by the developers themselves through a number of sources. I'll save you the trouble of having to visit all these websites by packaging everything you need to know in one video. Now, I am going to assume that you've watched the trailer analysis, so be sure to check that out first if you haven't done so yet. Anyways, without further ado, let's dive right into it. Let's begin by talking about the first episode, which begins on December 31st, 1958, the night before the fall of Rapture. To some degree, you could say that Burial at Sea is a prequel to Bioshock 1, an origin story of sorts. Players will assume the role of Booker DeWitt once again, or an alternate version of him as far as we know. The complicated father-daughter relationship between Booker and Elizabeth will once again take spotlight, but under completely different light and circumstances, likely in a completely different timeline altogether. And yes, since the game begins the night before the fall of Rapture, players will actually be able to experience a living and breathing version of Rapture for an extended period of time. Even though this portion doesn't feature any combat, according to Ken Levine, it's still his favorite part. He also hints at Booker meeting an old friend from Bioshock 1 before the fall of Rapture. He says, not a very nice friend, but a friend. Which character from Bioshock 1 will be acquainted with Booker, I wonder? Anyways, one shit hits the fan, the second half of Episode 1 begins, during which players experience the beginning of Rapture's decay. This portion will take place in a Fontaine department store that's been shuttered and sunk to the bottom of the ocean by Andrew Ryan. Before the event, all of Fontaine's cronies had been put in there, and the worst part is that they are all spliced up down there. By the time Booker is somehow added into the mix, they have all gone crazy. The combination of all these circumstances sets up the second half of Episode 1 of Burial at Sea, which Ken Levine is hoping to be a more traditional Bioshock 1 experience. Gameplay-wise, Episode 1 will retain the core mechanics from Infinite, with the obvious exceptions of things like skyhooks and skylines. Basic things like moving and shooting will feel familiar. Hell, players will even be drinking plasmids in this game like Vigors, instead of injecting them like plasmids from Bioshock 1. According to Ken Levine, there is a reason behind drinking plasmids, which will be explained in-game. Now, while the core mechanics will remain the same, the feel of the game will be different. Ken Levine aims to retune the feel of the experience by making combat more player-initiated. What does he mean by that? Well, if you recall, in Bioshock Infinite, players didn't really have much leeway in deciding whether to engage the enemy or not. Once the wave of enemies arrived, players were forced to fight no matter what. In Bioshock 1, on the other hand, players had more freedom in choosing between fighting roaming enemies like Big Daddies or to leave them be. And if players chose to engage the enemy, they actually had the time to look around the environment, set some traps, and really think about how they would tackle the encounter. This slower pace and flexibility that Bioshock 1 offered is something that Ken Levine aims to bring back in Burial at Sea Episode 1 by using level design more akin to Bioshock 1 while retaining the core feel, mechanics, and systems of Bioshock Infinite. Now let's talk about Episode 2, which features an interesting twist. Players will actually assume the role of Elizabeth. While Episode 1's story revolves around both Booker and Elizabeth, Episode 2's story has been described simply as Elizabeth's story. Ken Levine believes that enough has been explored about Elizabeth by the end of both Bioshock Infinite and Burial at Sea Episode 1 to allow players to assume her role. Now, a big topic of contention out there is which Elizabeth will players be controlling. Is this the same Elizabeth from Bioshock Infinite? While Ken Levine wouldn't go too much into detail, he does confirm that this Elizabeth is one that has seen all the things the players have seen by the end of Bioshock Infinite, which has had an effect on her. The level designer Amanda Jeffrey says that Elizabeth in Rapture is a continuation to the one in Infinite. Now keep in mind that the Bioshock franchise has gotten a shit ton more complex with the introduction of Dimension, so I wouldn't assume that this Elizabeth is the exact same flesh from Bioshock Infinite, but she does become somewhat omniscient by the end of the game, which may have had an effect on all the Elizabeths in other dimensions, so who knows. But the point is, she's not a completely brand new, clueless Elizabeth, just one that has changed after what she has seen and been through. So what about gameplay for episode 2? Ken Levine has talked about how he wanted Elizabeth to feel different from Booker, since the two are such different characters. Booker is an ex-soldier and a more head-on kind of guy, while Elizabeth always takes a more considerate and careful approach to everything. This is why Ken Levine has decided to make Elizabeth's campaign play more like a survival horror rather than a shooter. In other words, when playing as Elizabeth, players will not be running and gunning. Rather, they'll be fighting for survival in a much smarter way. Things like saving ammunition, using the environment to bypass enemies, or setting up traps will play much bigger roles in episode 2. Now, of course, Elizabeth is no ordinary girl. Many of you pointed out the thimble on her pinky, suggesting that part of her pinky is in another dimension, also suggesting that she retains her ability to open tears to other dimensions. Ken Levine himself has recently confirmed that players will have access to tear abilities in episode 2 when playing as Elizabeth, while Ken Levine does say that Elizabeth will have far more powerful ways to interact with the environment with her abilities than ever before. He also emphasizes that tears aren't just some kind of a win button. Don't expect to open a tear and unleash hell on enemies or anything like that. Tears will likely play a role in setting up traps or adding new things to the environment that will allow Elizabeth to defend herself, avoid enemies, open pathways, or navigate the environment, but nothing that will break the game. Ken and his team are still fiddling around with the tear mechanic, but he does emphasize that the whole idea of constants and variables is still there, meaning that there's only so much Elizabeth can change with her abilities. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, everything we know about Burial at Sea Episode 1 and 2 thus far. I love the idea of experiencing both a pristine rapture and a traditional rapture side by side, and I cannot wait to see how Elizabeth will play like. I'm still very curious to see what kinds of weapons and powers, both new and familiar, players will have access to in this game, particularly when controlling Elizabeth, but I'm sure we'll find out in time. Be sure to let our nation know in the comments below if you have any interesting theories or facts that could shine more light on the game's story and gameplay, and to be further updated on BioShock, be sure to join the nation and subscribe to Yong Gear. I'll see you guys next time. Thank you very much, and Yong out.